Okay, I think I will start because there are still people that are trying to log in. So, but I will start with the introduction because else we will run out of time and it would be a waste because we have a very interesting program today. Today we have the DASH webinar on artificial intelligence in orthopedic and trauma surgery. My name is Peter van Ooyen. I'm the coordinator of the machine learning lab of DASH. And I will be moderating this session today, where we have three presentations on this topic. You're here in a meeting organized by DASH, a data science center in health of the UMCG. At DASH, we try to get more information about data science into the UMCG. We do that by different things. These are the building blocks that we have. For some reason, my presentation goes haywire and starts to go to the next slide all the time. These are the things we do. So we look at supporting projects in data science within the UMCG. We are on community building. And this is also part of that community building. Also education, where this is also part of trying to give education on data science to people within the UMCG outside, and also share what we are doing in the field of data science within the UMCG. Other things are the machine learning lab that I already mentioned, helping with funding and trying to find funding opportunities for data science project. Looking at the needs within the UMCG in all those different areas, collaborating with outside partners, and communicating about the different activities that we have and the different projects that are going on in the UMCG. Today, we will have a session with three presenters. We will ask you all to keep your microphones on mute. If you want to ask a question, you can either type it in the chat. You can find it on the right side of the screen where you have that purple button where you can go to the chat, type in your question, and we'll either do it in between or we do it after the session. You can also, with the button on the bottom of the screen, you can raise your hand, and if we give you the microphone, then you can turn on your microphone and ask your question in that way. So both is possible. We have to inform you that this webinar will be recorded, so it will be available also through our website later on after this session. Today's webinar, we have three presentations. The first one will be Job Doornberg. He's an orthopedic trauma surgeon at Flinders Medical Center and an associate professor at Flinders University in Adelaide, Australia. And he will give a clinical overview of the applications of natural language processing, machine learning, and deep learning by showing all kinds of examples for each topic from their own research. Then Vincent Stirler will present a trauma surgeon at the UMCG. And he will show a specific use case, a deep learning project on detecting pneumothorax and rib fractures on chest X-rays that is running within the UMCG. And finally, we will have Ludo Cornelissen, a postdoc researcher at the machine learning lab of the UMCG, who will talk about the technical side of this use case that was introduced by Vincent and give information on the different methods that we to provide insight into the results. So with that, I would like to give the microphone to Job Doornberg to kick off with the first presentation in this session. Job, the floor is yours.
Good morning, and thanks so much. Thank you, Linda, for organizing a great session, and Peter for this invitation. Let me try to share my screen. We practiced that a few minutes ago, so that should be easy. So So, as Peter said, I'll be hovering around the subject of clinical applications of artificial intelligence. And then Vincent will go into a clinical case and Ludo more in depth into the technical aspects. Research is something you do in a team. I just want to show this picture that if you're considering a PhD and you like the outdoor life in Australia, please sign up and let Peter know that you're in for it. AI needs collaboration. You will hear that in the next two talks as well. If you develop an algorithm in one center, it will not be externally valid in other centers. And we are lucky enough to have PhDs around the globe and three continents. And we, I will show you examples how we collaborate. This is the UMGG team. On the top left, you will see Frank. You will see more of him in this presentation. This is Vincent talking to you in the second talk, and Ludo here. And this is our team of high potentials doing distal radius, ankle, and extorax projects. So where are we if we talk about artificial intelligence? Obviously, there was a big hype, and there were big expectations. And in medicine, one could argue that we are maybe a little bit on the way down to the trough of dissolution. Potentially, you can argue that, and I'm going to argue this case a little bit. But I think in the end, there will be a plateau of productivity, because if the computer if we manage to train the computer to do the simple stuff, we potentially have more time for our patients again. So to visualize that, I think this is how the situation currently is. Computer is basically obstructing our patient-doctor relationship. The computer works in many ways potentially for us, but most of the time you spend with a patient, you spend virtually on the computer. And I think in the end, AI will help us to for the computer to become more like an assistant to us, and that may allows us to spend more time with our patients. And forget about the boring stuff of putting your notes in and all that stuff. So how and what are the aspects of AI that can help us? NLP, natural language processing, is one. I will talk briefly on that. Machine learning, I will talk a little bit on that. And then ultimately, computer vision. That's something that Vincent and Ludo will talk more in depth about. So if you talk about NLP, you can imagine that the computer overhears your history taking. Whatever the patient tells you, the computer can pick up key elements, and the patient always tells you the diagnosis, is what we've learned. So the computer can pick up those key elements, even make your notes, and even make a differential diagnosis. That's something that's already happening in other fields. Machine learning can help you with risk stratification. Which patient has a scaphoid fracture, and if you would operate, what are the probabilities of a good outcome? Machine learning backed up with very good data, because that is key. You need good quality data, can help you with that as well. So I'm going to talk briefly about our flaws, the human flaws, our biases, and then you automatically come to surgeon biases. It's all about pattern recognition. We humans are very good in recognizing patterns, and the computer is, can be taught to recognize patterns as well. We all know this diagram, and we all know that the middle line looks like it's the longest, but we also all know that they're all the same length. And our system one tells us the middle line is the longest, but our system two tells us no, you've seen this before, they're all of the same length. And this is extensively studied and described in a great book. I can really recommend you guys reading this book, Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman. And that basically tells you about pattern recognition and all the human flaws we have. If you translate this book to doctors and to surgeons in particular, a great example is what you see is all there is. That's something Kahneman alludes to a lot. And what you see is all there is something that we as surgeons causes biases with surgeons. So the most famous example is arthroscopic surgery of the knee in patients that are, let's say, 50 years and older with degenerative meniscal tears. So after the age of 50, we all are going to get tears of our meniscus at some point in life. So if you make an MRI of people over 50, you will find meniscal tears. But back in the day, we all thought, okay, this is a tear, we need to fix it, or we need to excise it. And so we started scoping these knees, excising those tears, and patients did very well. We as surgeons saw patients back, and patients were very happy. And we thought they're happy with us and with our operations. And that's where what you see is all the risk comes into play, because the patients that do very well and are happy as well, without surgery, those are the patients we don't see. And now there's plenty of evidence to show that an arthroscopic debridement of a meniscal tear is obsolete. It's not necessary anymore. So that is where our biases and errors as humans come into play as doctors. And this is very well described by Professor Ian Harris, another book I would recommend. It is not directly related to AI, but in reality, it really is, because all we are going to do with AI is train computers to recognize patterns, but we have to first understand our own flaws and then down the line understand computers' flaws. So we all have AI in our hands. This is my phone. You can recognize Frank Ipma yet again here. And this is how many surgeons' phones look like. You have family pictures, holiday pictures, some limbs, and an intraoperative picture. But what I find very, very cool is that our computer starts categorizing these pictures. And you can see here that it categorizes our children. But what you can also recognize a flaw. It says that we have three boys and four children in total. But in reality, we have five children, but we have twin girls. And these twin girls, even though they're in the same picture, are picked up as one by our computer algorithm. Unfortunately, this is not medicine, so this flaw is not really important. But if you go into medicine, that can be very important. So this is why I think we are now on the downfall to the trough of dissolution. And that's what I'm going to talk about a little bit. But in the end, I do believe it's not going to be a negative story that we will reach the plateau of productivity. So in the last 10 minutes, I will talk about NLP a little bit about machine learning, and finally touch on computer vision. Natural language processing, we all know. I didn't really know what a trough meant, but it's a trough in Dutch, and therefore it explains the curve. But NLP can be used for many things. In medicine, you can think of the computer overhearing history taken with a patient, making notes, even making differential diagnosis. But in the field of orthopedic trauma and trauma surgery, we're not there yet. Where we use it for is to look at operative reports and find complications. So an example of a complication is a durotomy during spine surgery. Basically, you hit the membrane that covers the spinal cord, and it leaks spinal fluid. And that's a complication. If you want to report on spinal surgery, you want to know the incidence of, or the how often it occurs. But it's a pain to go through all those operative reports. So if you have an automated NLP algorithm that does that for you, that would be great. And Aditya is the WizKid in Boston, starting as a medical student with Professor Schwab. And he wrote many of those programs. And he has a very good internal validation for this NLP automated detection for durotomy. However, when we applied his algorithm to our operative reports in Adelaide, his algorithm performed very, very poorly. And that is despite it's still English, it's medical English, so it shouldn't differ too much. And we also have complications in Adelaide, durotomies. So that shouldn't be the issue either. What is the issue? And this is basically a very simple metaphor for the problems you will encounter in machine learning, in AI in general, is that an internally validated algorithm, be it computer vision or NLP in this case, is not necessarily valid in other centers. And to explain this is basically that your slippers in Boston are called flip-flops, while in the other side of the world they're called thongs. So this is a language barrier that also occurs in medicine. And if you remember one thing of this talk, please remember these flip-flops. Flip-flops in Boston are different from flip-flops in Adelaide. And so external validation of any algorithm may not be as valid. I just want to show this to go into machine learning. This is Ram. He learned how to surf in Adelaide, as well as learned how to program in R, and he made a very useful prediction tool to predict post-mal fractures associated with tibial shaft fractures. And he even created a little app for that. I just wanted to show you that you can both do a PhD and learn how to surf at the same time. I will go into depth a little bit more about an algorithm we also developed, and that's about scaphoid fractures. This is Anne-Yves. Anne-Yves is our scaphoid PhD who just left Adelaide. And the clinical scenario is as follows. You have a patient with a fall on the outstretched arm presenting to ED. And this patient has radial-sided wrist pain. And the emergency doctor thinks it may be a scaphoid fracture. So the patient is sent to radiography. The radiography comes back, the plain x-rays come back, and it does not show a fracture. So this patient is clinically suspect for a fracture, while on the radiograph you don't see a fracture. The problem is that in 1 in 5 patients, or 1 in 6, these patients actually do have a fracture, but it's just not visible on radiographs. And this, the way we treat these patients very defensively is send them off with 2 weeks in a cast and then reevaluate them at 2 weeks. Well, that's a big burden to the patient. They will be immobilized for 2 weeks. So what we do in Adelaide, and some centers around the world do it somewhat differently, but we do an MRI right away to exclude a fracture, and we can send off patients without a cast so they can go on with their lives. But then what happens is you make MRIs for 4 out of 5 patients without that really need to be. So that's a big burden on our healthcare system. So what Anne-Yves did is combine data from Edinburgh and Amsterdam to make a clinical prediction model to predict the rate of a scaphoid fracture, the probability of a scaphoid fracture in the scenario I just described. So a patient with a clinically suspect scaphoid fracture, but a radiograph that is negative. And she found 4 predictors in those combined databases. And I just want to allude that we are publishing this stuff in a consortium with all authors equal. So that makes data sharing very easy, because you basically cut out egos. So you have 4 predictors, sex, age, mechanism, age, and only 1 clinical assessment test, that's pain in the anatomic snuff box on ulnar deviation. And she came up with this algorithm. So a patient, a male patient of 30 years old, sustaining the injury at sports and pain on ulnar deviation will result in a probability fracture of 80%. So this patient should get an MRI, we think, even though the fracture is not visible on radiographs. So if you apply that algorithm, this is a normal situation. We have 300 plus patients without a fracture on the radiographs, but they all get an MRI. And then we have 305 patients without a fracture and 18 patients with a fracture. This is a big waste of money. So if you apply this algorithm and you will set the threshold at 10%, then all of a sudden you don't need an MRI in these 100 patients, and you do an MRI, still a lot of patients, 222, but you don't miss out on any fractures. At least this is the external validation of this algorithm on Adelaide patients. And Marushka is our scaphoid PhD. She will now prospectively validate this, and potentially you will see pictures of her beach volleyballing in Adelaide. Now, the final machine learning algorithm I'd like to discuss with you is one that we are going to prospectively evaluate in Groningen. And that's under the supervision of Peter, because we get dedicated support from DASH to do this. So the clinical scenario is as follows. This is a 67-year-old patient I saw early this year, and she twisted her hip and fractured it. That means there's something wrong, and indeed it was. She has breast cancer, and this is a metastatic fracture. And for her treatment decision, it's very important what her life expectancy will be. So on one hand, if she has very short life expectancy, you will treat it with a nail. But if she has a longer life expectancy, you would do much more extensive operation to really treat her, because the fracture won't heal and at some point the nail will break if she lives long enough. So prediction of scaphoid fracture is one thing, but prediction of somebody's survival is another, and that's more complex and it has more variables. And in her case, the survival is only 6%, so we decided to do an intramedullary nail. But the cool thing is now that the DASH team is actually facilitating that all these variables will go automatically into this algorithm. So that means when the patient presents and you get bloods and you get tumor histology, it will all fall into this algorithm and you will know the survival probability of this patient. And so another example of collaboration, this algorithm was developed by Corina in Boston again. She's a PhD, but we are now prospectively testing that in Groningen. And the cool thing is that Professor Schwab doesn't have the resources to do that. He doesn't have a team in place that can put the algorithm into EPIC, and DASH took up the challenge. So we're very grateful for that. And potentially this will be a proof of concept for other departments wanting to put algorithms into EPIC as well. Just briefly on computer vision then, to introduce Vincent with another example of pattern recognition, because computer vision is still pattern recognition. This is Luke Johnson. He's an orthopedic oncology surgeon, like Professor Jutte, head of the Department of Orthopedic Surgery in Groningen, but he's also a chef. And he's a cook, so he writes his cookbooks together with his wife, who makes the photos, who's a GP. And this is the photo that you see often in surgeons' phones, and it's categorized in his phone as food subcategory meat. And in his case, that makes sense to some extent, but it doesn't make sense at all, of course. So that's another flaw of AI. And in my phone, it shows that these intraoperative pictures are under the category of dining. But what can AI do for us, and in particular computer vision, is recognize fractures. And then again, I'm going to be a little bit critical, because it's easy to recognize fractures. We all see this fracture, but the AI algorithm, the CNN algorithm, does see it as well. But in the upward slope of inflated expectations, these guys got $100 million to basically based on this, that they can recognize fractures. But we really want to know, is this fracture stable or not? Does this patient need an operation? And those are more challenging questions. And to conclude and come back to the scaphoid example, if we can see that scaphoid fracture on a radiograph, it would be cool if a CNN algorithm can. And we're not there yet. So if you look here, the accuracy of orthopedic surgery is 85. That's not great. But the CNN doesn't perform great either. So we're still finding ways to implement this. So in conclusion, we're coming down here. But I'm looking forward to join you guys on the slope of enlightenment in a collaborative fashion with the UMC Greek group, Boston group, and also the Adelaide groups together, and to get to the plateau of productivity. Thanks so much.
Hey, thank you, Job. I see that somebody has their hand up there. Do you want to ask a question? Then go ahead.
Yes, and just regarding the last slide you showed about the AI and the surgeon prediction of scaphoid fracture, you didn't do a comparison of a surgeon using the AI, because the real life scenario would be a surgeon using the AI versus a surgeon not using the AI, instead of just comparing AI alone versus a surgeon looking at the image.
Yeah, that's a great idea. So no, we didn't. No, the current way we approach these studies is to compare the AI, so the CNN algorithm, separately from a panel of experienced surgeons. But it's a great idea to combine both, because that's the clinical reality. That's how we study, for example, 3D handheld models as well. We do that in addition to the normal CTs and not only the 3D model. So for this algorithm, we can do the same. Yeah, good idea.
Okay. Any other burning questions in between? Because if not, then we'll move on to the next presentation. Thanks again, Job. And we move on to Vincent Sterler to talk about the clinical use cases in the UMCG. It was already introduced partly by Job, so I will give the floor to Vincent.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, great. thank you for the great ideas. I would love to be on the slope of enlightenment. I miss that often in my life, but you gave me hope. So I will join you on that slope of enlightenment. I have the same kind of thanks I would give out to everyone is that, first of all, thank you for the invitation to talk about the subject I really care about, because I get to work on very interesting ideas, and above all, I get to work with a team of people who have the same motivation, but with different perspectives and from various different backgrounds. So whatever you may take from this webinar, I would like to impress upon you that our successes and ideas in this field are the consequences of team effort, just like Job have shared with you. We feel the same, and I'm thankful for that. And Ludo will share with you at the end acknowledgements in name at the end of his talk. So I have nothing to disclose. And my section of this webinar can be split into two ideas. There's a very big idea that's not mine, it's not ours, it's not even from this century, and it started with computer-aided diagnosis. And this path was created by this idea, and we still walk upon this path. And the second idea is a very small idea, which is ours, and that's the use case. And I will introduce this use case to you all, and Ludo will further enlighten you on the technical aspects of it. So I think everyone knows there's a shift in healthcare from a situation where the patient conforms to the doctor in the biggest sense of the word or idea. Now doctors tend to conform themselves more to the individual patients and their needs, situations and preferences. So doctors can be substituted by healthcare professionals or healthcare systems in general in this sense. And this shift is gearing towards precision medicine, where we, amongst other things, attempt to improve disease detection and try to prevent a disease from progressing. And we have a part to play in this field of image analysis. And that is, artificial intelligence is just not the right term. We are in the field of machine learning, deep learning. And what is important to ask ourselves is, can we translate the developments from the laboratory into clinical practice? Is it translational? I think it is, and yes, we can. Job has showed you some examples of that, and I would like to introduce the use case where we try to attempt the same thing. So it started with a very big idea in the end of the 50s, beginning of the 60s, with this radiologist called Gwilym Lodwick. And he believed that a computer could aid in establishing diagnosis as a radiologist. So he developed an algorithm that would identify abnormalities on a chest X-ray. And he did that in the traditional way. So he wrote code, which became the rules of analyzing an image. And he fed data, the images, into the computer. And then he would get the answers, the diagnosis, if you will, or labels, the term we use nowadays in machine learning. But he was not successful. He attempted to reach his goal his whole life, but he never became, he never got there. And one of the reasons is this. On the background, lots of guys in suits from IBM and always others, a smaller group, pushing a huge crate into a lorry. And in this crate is a 5 megabyte hard drive. Nowadays, we discard more powerful devices carelessly without thinking about it. But things have changed. We had a obstruction of our sewer system a couple of weeks ago, and with the video, they found that there's a Nokia smartphone in our sewer system, which is probably more powerful than the huge computer Lodewijk used back in his days. So, picture of Ludo here, because obviously he's our man who trains the models and all other exciting stuff in the lab. And we would still feed data into our model, but we give it the answers instead of thinking up the rules. So the answers are the labels of the diagnosis of the images, and the data are the images themselves, and the network, the model, will devise its own rules. And in that sense, be successful. At least we think, we hope. So around 2013 and 2014, machine learning, and more specifically deep learning with its use of neural networks, made significant advances in object detection methods of very large variety of images, like ImageNet, from cute puppies to other inanimate objects, thank you, Darth Vader here, easily recognizable nowadays. And on the left, you can appreciate a collection of images from a paper by Rosakowski with a very cool title, Detecting Avocados and Zucchinis. And they developed a model that easily identified the subjects in these images. And you may notice that these subjects in these images are mostly centered and well visible. And this may be ideal in a laboratory setting, but does not reflect reality outside the laboratory. Nowadays, objects can be identified from a moving car and at dusk when it's raining. But back then, it had to be simple like this. A bit later, in 2015, on the right side, you can see a collection of images from a paper by Donyu. And they investigated whether models built on deep convolutional networks are effective for tasks such as visual understanding. And they demonstrate in their paper that models can recognize activity and thus supply an image with a caption or a video with a description. And they're quite good at it. If you look at the top left one, a female tennis player in action on the court, and a baseball game in progress with the batter up to plate, but it wasn't perfect. This is not a woman, this is a man. No woman would lie on the bed in short pants and keep their white socks on. So it got close, but no cigar yet. Nowadays, it's much better. So are we heading this way then? Are we in need of models providing captions or descriptions for medical images? Would you appreciate it when a model evaluates a cerebral CT scan and provides you with the caption that there's a right-sided subarachnoid hemorrhage? You may find this useful, but how would you know that the model was right? When are you able to trust it completely? So personally, I think this particular situation is not close to happening and is not ideal, and doctors, whatever others may think, are not easily supplanted by models. What I do think will happen is this, and there's a situation of synergy between a doctor here, a bright young doctor who employs a neural network, a model, a tool, an instrument, and thus boosts its her or his performance without catching flame, I just realized. But the idea is synergy, it's not substitution. And I can illustrate this assumption with a recent paper from Wang et al. From last year. And in it, they have done something very interesting and concerns this synergy between doctors and models. They have developed a deep learning-based automated detection model, which is abbreviated as DLAD on this slide. You can see that on top in the title. And they developed this model for the diagnosis of several different types of chest pathologies like malignancies, active tuberculosis, or pneumonia. they recruited three different types of doctors, which you can appreciate here in this column. Non-radiology physicians, you can imagine these are MO's from the front room or the emergency department, or in Dutch, the spoedeisenhulpartsen. And then general radiologists and special thoracic radiologists. And each group contained five of these doctors with the same qualifications. And these groups were subjected to two sessions where they had to evaluate the 100 chest radiographs in random order. For every image, they had to give a diagnosis, a label, if you will, and localize the pathology if it was present, or an annotation, if you will. In session one, they had to perform this task on their own. They had to finish it without a time limit. And in session two, they were exposed to the prediction of an algorithm, the said algorithm that could detect these pathologies. And they were given a measure of confidence of the algorithm, and they were given a heat map, just like you can see in the right image, where the algorithm has designated the area of interest. And then something very interesting happened, and that was synergy. So in the first column, on the first half, you can see session one. Below it is session two. So let's look at the performance in session one. The performance, obviously, of a non-radiology physician was less well or good, I mean, than the specialist thoracic radiologist, but overall, 81% to 93%. But synergy kicked in, and then the performance got boosted in accuracy. So you might think, okay, that's just performance. What about other metrics? So let's scoot over to sensitivity column. So first, the non-radiology physicians, they scored had a sensitivity of 69. But after they were exposed to the model, they performed much better. And the same is applied to the radiologists in general and the specialist radiologists. They all increased the sensitivity. But, and that's very interesting, it was not to the detrimental effect of specificity. Their specificity, the way they could exclude that a pathology was present in the image, did not decline. They were just as good as excluding the pathology as finding the pathology. So, where Lodewijk developed an idea based on computer-aided diagnosis, we continue on this path with image analysis. And based on this paper, I personally believe that models based on machine learning, deep learning, whatever technique in this field, will not supplant doctors themselves, but rather augment the performance of doctors. And I think that's the big idea. Right. Now for something a little bit different, and that's a small idea. And that is the introduction of the use case. Trauma is the third leading cause of death in the whole Western population after heart disease and malignancies. So it's still out there. It happens every day in every hospital. And thoracic trauma accounts for approximately 25% of total trauma-associated mortality in the Western population. And amongst other thoracic injuries, a traumatic pneumothorax is a potentially lethal condition. This can occur in up to 15% of cases with blunt trauma to the thorax, and even more in multi-trauma cases. And you can imagine that the timely diagnosis and adequate treatment of a traumatic pneumothorax may limit adverse outcomes. And ideally, if you want to make a chest radiograph, the best way possible you can, you have to put a patient upright, with his chest against the collector and the beam just behind his chest, so the distance between the beam of the source and the collector is as small as possible. But in trauma patients, it's the worst possible situation. So this is a picture from my duty call last week, and I told everyone there present I would make them anonymous, and I will not bother you with corny jokes like this is the surgeon who's like a banana, it's bright, it's strong and upright, but when you peel the skin off, it's really soft on the inside. Or the tomato there, that's the anesthetist team, and they're always trying to play catch up. I will not do that. I want to point out that in this image, the patient is lying here supine. And the projector, the X-ray beam source, is way above the patient. And it's in an antero-posterior direction with the collector somewhere here under the bed. So we're getting the worst possible chest radiographs. Most often, an overt pneumothorax can usually be diagnosed in this fashion, but regularly it is difficult to spot, especially in cases where pneumothorax is ventral and only an indirect sign may suggest its presence. So this is a picture from the same trauma. A couple of minutes later, the chest radiograph was made and can be visible from the station, away from all the caregivers next to the patient, or somewhere on a small screen on the wall. It's important that receiving the right diagnosis is critical to receiving the appropriate care, but is human performance constant of quality and intensity? And it is not. A diagnostic error will occur in the care of nearly every patient in his or her lifetime. This is a given fact. It even plays an important role in patient deaths. This is investigated in many, many, many studies. So the use of a model that augments the performance of a doctor may mediate these effects. That would be quite interesting to see. So we developed a hypothesis. Deep learning based algorithm can accurately identify pneumothorax in trauma patients on a chest radiograph in the actual clinical situation. And our aim was to develop and test this algorithm model. And for that end, we created a group. The group only became larger, and I can again agree with Job that the team effort is very important. And at one point, this is a flow diagram from a while back. It's not the numbers we have now, but what is important in this flow diagram, you start out with 2,792 patients, but in the end, you discard a lot of patients because either the chest radiograph was not accessible or retrievable from the archiving system. Archiving systems from the 90s, evil, hellish things that can be improved upon, in my opinion. Or chest radiographs were not usable. So in the end, you end up with a lot less image files. And it's because of an idea. There are considerable challenges due to the complexity and often very poor quality of imaging data. So the lessons learned from these ideal pictures is not easily transferred to the situation we have in healthcare with images. So image on the left, most of these pixels will tell you that there's a puppy there, sad but cute puppy, and this classification task is not very difficult. Image on the right, though, most of the pixels on that chest x-ray of a healthy person that happens to have lung cancer will tell you that the person is healthy. So it's only a small portion of the image that tells you that there's an important finding to classify. Images from chest x-rays or CT scans, whatever, they are huge. They're not kilobytes, they're gigabytes. And all this is mostly unlabeled in most hospitals around the world. And the quantity of these images, that was the point I want to make with the flow diagram, is that the quantity of useful images is much lower. So you can appreciate on this chest x-ray, parts of the chest are not on the image, on the bottom right or the bottom left. And there are a lot of foreign material inserted into the patient or onto the patient. There's a chest tube here in the pleural cavity. There's a tube in the upper airway after intubation, and you can see the sensors from an electrocardiogram. This is noise. And this is an image from the performance of our model. This is from last year, I think, where this is a true positive for a pneumothorax. The pneumothorax has been highlighted by us humans in a bounding box, but the model said there's a pneumothorax correctly, but based on this heat map, It thought so because there was a drain inserted. So we have to deal with all sorts of stuff like this. A model should not make a guess or a prediction based on the drain. It should be able to detect the pneumothorax itself. Right. That is the use case where we've put a lot of work in labeling, which is tedious work, but necessary. And these are two of the six students who work with us in our group, not on the pneumothorax, but on rib fractures. And I would like to give them 30 seconds of fame because they do such a great job. And we try to help the model understand what is what. So they annotate the chest. In pink, you can see that they've segmented the lung. In yellow, it's the pneumothorax. And in these small purple or blue boxes are the rib fractures with a spot of green on the bottom right, which is an indirect sign for a pneumothorax itself. Where are we now? This is the point where I hand over to Ludo. We are somewhere here between lab and pilot. And Ludo, the floor is yours. Thank you for your attention, everyone.
All right. Thanks a lot, Vincent, for the introduction of the clinical use case. So I think we might go straight to what I would like to share with all of you in view of time. So my name is Ludo Cornelis. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the Machine Learning Lab of the UMCG. And I'll give the technical perspective and the results that we have so far of this project on pneumothorax detection. So as Vincent already nicely introduced, when you want to do deep learning for medical imaging, you run into several problems. Actually, you have to realize that you'll be doing mostly learning from small data because of all these points that were mentioned, images that are not available or just limited size of the data sets. So a typical data set in medical imaging might be 1,000. Okay, if you have a very large, it might be 10,000 patients. It's very hard to collect more than that in this domain. And on top of that, you're often dealing with very complicated problems. It takes years of training to make a diagnosis. And this also makes the annotations, the labels that you need, very expensive to obtain. So for the case of pneumothorax specifically, there are other complicating factors. The diagnosis, as Vincent explained, is often made on the X-ray, but the true gold standard is the CT scan. And especially in the case of trauma patients, CT is often not available just because of the time and effort involved to move the patient to the CT room. And in a critical situation, this is often not feasible. And on top of that, you have the pneumothorax can be located in different locations. So if you have a lateral pneumothorax, meaning on the side of the lung, this is quite often readily detected on an X-ray, but the ventral pneumothorax is much harder to spot. So the question that we are trying to answer while going embarking on this project that has been running for a bit more than a year now is, how can we make the most out of this limited data that we have? And to do that, what we realize, we have to switch from between global and local labels. So this is really machine learning terminology. I'm going to explain what that means. Because a lot of these deep learning projects on chest X-rays actually use global labels. And a global label is something like this. a statement, there is a pneumothorax in this image. So it's a label that concerns the whole, the image as a whole. Whereas a local label is, it's a subtle difference, but in a local label, you would say, here is the pneumothorax in this image. And then you you annotate the regions in the image that pertain to the pneumothorax. So in this case, the lung, healthy lung tissue is green, and the pneumothorax regions are marked in red. And just to show some more examples, Vincent also already showed an example, but so these annotations are made by the student Estafula and Bendix, and they've really made an effort to annotate our entire data set in this way. And you can, if you're using local labels, you can even go a step further. So here you see also these blue markings, blue regions in the image. And that means that in this case, they've marked regions of subcutaneous emphysema, which can be an indirect sign of a pneumothorax. And so what we are now trying to do is to have our model learn to recognize these regions, but also give us the correct global label, of course, whether there is a pneumothorax, yes or no. So the approach we're taking on that is segmentation-assisted classification. So segmentation pertains to identifying those regions, really giving local predictions on the image. And classification means trying to find the correct global label. So very schematically, our model that we are using currently looks like this. We have an input. We have the chest radiograph images. We feed that into a modern classification network. In our case, we use EfficientNet. And this classification network is very good at predicting a global output, so a classification output. And then on top of that, we attach a UNet, which is a famous architecture for segmentation. So we're going to use this UNet to give us the segmentation output, so the localization in the image. And well, as you can see, I made these kind of horizontal connections here. So that implies that these models are really attached to each other. And the idea is now that the classification task will also be able to benefit from the segmentation labels. So while we're trying to optimize the classification and the segmentation output, hopefully they will also cross over to each other and benefit from each other. And what we expect is that this will go more from segmentation to classification, because the information we're giving to the model when we're training the segmentation task is much stronger than only the global labels you're using for this classification output. So when you're thinking about the model like this, you also have to realize, like, how can we make the model actually learn from our data and from our labels? And for that, you have to define what is known as a loss function. Or a cost function, it's also called sometimes. So this is essentially your optimization objective. This is how you make the model gain experience from the data. So during the process of training a model, we want to minimize this cost or this loss. And this is general for any machine learning approach, by the way. So for our, we actually need two of those, because we have two different tasks. So you have a classification task and a segmentation task. And for our classification loss, we use a very standard loss function. We use a weighted binary cross entropy. This is very common now in many, many machine learning projects nowadays. Whereas for the segmentation, we use the Dice coefficient. I'm just going to briefly explain what that is, because I don't think many people will be familiar with it. The Dice coefficient is essentially a measure that quantifies how well two areas overlap. So you can imagine if I have some certain area that is my label, which is my ground truth. So in this case, this green part would be the region of the pneumothorax. Then my model can give a certain prediction, which, you know, might have partial overlap, but it's probably also partially wrong. And now I can compare these two areas and I can divide it into four parts. So we have a part where the model is correct. This would be the true positives. We have a part of the ground truth that we miss. Those are the false negatives. And we have a part of the prediction that is false positive. So that's this part here. And then outside of both prediction and ground truth are the true negative. It's the true negative region. And now the Dice coefficient is defined like this. It's twice the true positives over twice the true positives plus false negatives plus false positives. And this is great, but there's a problem. So not all pneumothoraces can be segmented in an image. And this is actually particularly hard for ventral pneumothoraxes that were already hard to detect in the first place. So one of the problems that we ran into was, how can we handle those images that are very hard to segment? How can we still make our model learn maybe from the global label? So because we cannot make a ground truth in terms of segmentation, of course, we still know that there is a pneumothorax in the image, so we can still learn at least the global classification task. So how we did that is by making use of, instead of the real dice, we use a masked dice coefficient. That means that I should note the maximum value that this part of the dice can reach is 1. So 1 means perfect overlap, and the minimum value it can attain is 0. That means no overlap at all. And so in a masked dice coefficient, what we essentially say is that we always assign a perfect score if there is no mask in the image. So if there's no ground truth, then this dice will always be 1. And that means that we are not penalizing the model if it makes any segmentation prediction on either images that are negative for pneumothorax, so where there is nothing, or images in which the pneumothorax is not annotated, so like those difficult ventral pneumothorax images. This has several advantages, or actually the most important advantage is that we can just use all the images in the data set for training, even if we don't have those segmentation annotations. But the downside is that we are quite likely gonna have some over-segmentation, right? Because we are not penalizing the model for wrong segmentations on images that don't really have a pneumothorax. So that's something you have to realize from this. That's a consequence of this choice. All right, so we've defined the model, we've defined the loss function, so the way for the model to gain experience. And then we have to go into model training. And for that, we were very lucky that there is a pre-training data set for this particular task available. And that actually comes from a data science championship on pneumothorax detection. This was held on the platform Kaggle. Maybe some people in the audience will be familiar with that. So there was a bit less than a year ago, there was this competition on pneumothorax segmentation from the on the Kaggle platform. And the images from the competition, well, we participated in this competition with a team from the machine learning lab. So we got hold of the images, and they're really exactly what we need for our task. So that's really great. You can see here some examples of the image and also the pneumothorax outlined in the image. So this is all from the Kaggle competition. And this data set is pretty large. It's more than 10,000 images, of which 22% actually show a pneumothorax. And in all of these images, the pneumothorax is segmented. And there is also a test data set. And this Kaggle data set is actually a part of the more well-known chest X-ray 14 data set. So if you're ever researching on pneumothorax classification on chest X-rays, you are sure to come across this data set. It's a very, very commonly used public data set of X-ray images. And this Kaggle set is part of that. So we trained our model on this data set to give it a good starting point for use on our own real UMCG data. And of course, there are several differences between the Kaggle data and the UMCG data. And the most important, I think, being is that the Kaggle data set is not trauma patients specifically. And that really turned out to make a big difference. I'll show you that in a few moments. So while we were working on this, at the end of last year, a paper from Google Health came out. And they did a very nice thing. They revisited part of this chest X-ray 14 data set. So what they did is they corrected the labels on the data set, because there was a lot of debate whether these labels in chest X-ray 14, whether they were correct or not. And they also released their test set. So the set they used to test their model and the labels corresponding to that test set. And now this was a big effort. You have to realize correcting the labels. They use a panel of 18 radiologists to do that. So it was really a huge, huge effort. And they managed to score an AUC of 94% on their test set. And when I saw this, I thought, hey, this is exactly what we are doing. Because I should mention, this is the AOC for the pneumothorax detection problem. They look at other pathologies as well, but I'm just focusing on the pneumothorax here. So we tried our model on their test set, and actually we found that we got at least similar and maybe even slightly better performance. So here I show our ROC curve, where this cross marks the operating point of our model. And here in the bottom, you see the confusion matrix with the true negatives, true positives, and false negatives. So you can see that we have only 21 false negative images in this data set. So that means that our model really works very well also on this, this Google Health test data set. We were very hopeful to apply this model to our real UMCG data. And when we did that, actually what we found was rather disappointing. So here I show again an ROC curve where the green line is the same as what I just showed you, the ROC on the Google Health test set. And the blue line is the ROC on the UMCG data. So you see that it's really a lot worse. We go from 96 to 77%. So on our data set, it really doesn't work well at all. And this is where the importance of fine tuning comes in. So what I did to obtain this blue curve is just apply the same model that was developed on a different data set. It was developed on the Kaggle data set, and I just applied it directly to our UMCG data set containing different patients, trauma patients, and you see it does not work. However, when we now fine-tune the model, that means we're gonna start from the point where we left off with the Kaggle data set and now use the annotations that were made by Stavula and Bendix, among others, And we're going to retrain this model to make it more specific for the UMCG data set. And then what we got was these ROC curves. So now the colors mark the different data sets. There's a training set in green, testing set in orange, and a validation set in blue. And as you can see, our model now does very well on, of course, it does well on the training set because that's what we defined it to do. But also the validation and test set performance is very good. And you can see that for the operating point I selected here, we actually don't get any false negatives and we get two false positive predictions. So that is why fine tuning is so important. This relates to what was already introduced by Job early on, that you cannot just take one model, develop it in one center and expect it to work well in some other center. You have to work to do something to make that work. And that's something you have to do. That is what is known as fine tuning the model. And I should mention that in this process, of course, you sacrifice a bit on the performance on this chest X-ray 14 data set. I will show you that later on, that that performance actually goes down a little bit. So then we wanted to compare strategies. So what, of course, we come up with this new idea of combining classification segmentation. But what would happen if we would do only classification? So here I show the results on the test set. So the blue line is what we got with the combined approach, and the green one is with the classification only approach. Now this may seem like a huge difference, but it's not an entirely fair comparison. So for the blue line, I spent some time trying to optimize this model to fine tune the parameters a bit. So I'm quite sure that this green one can be improved as well. But so the way I read this is it's a good indication that our strategy is indeed working. There is some merit in doing this. And so we are on the right track in that sense. So this is based on our data set of UMCG trauma patients containing a bit more than 1,000 images, chest radiograph images in total. And we used the 80-10-10 split for the training, validation, and test sets. And this result is also based on 163 segmentations of the pneumothorax directly and 143 segmentations of the indirect regions. So the subcutaneous emphysema and also the deep sulcus sign that are both indirect signs of pneumothorax. So just to show you some results of the segmentation tasks, here you see the input image. The global prediction of the model is that there is a pneumothorax with a 99% probability. This is what was annotated on this image. And this is the regions that the model predicts. So I think you can clearly see the over-segmentation that we also more or less expected to occur, especially here down here for the subcutaneous emphysema. But for the pneumothorax, it seems to be more or less in the right spot. Another example. Here are the annotations, and these are the regions that are predicted. And you see that the model is still a bit put off by these, I think they are ECG leads. So it still confuses those for a pneumothorax because it's a line running through the lung. So it has to be improved on that. And the way to do that is to show it more data, I think. So what I would, as a final point, what I would like to share is our way of analyzing these results and going about this project. We've emphasized several times that this is really a multidisciplinary approach. And in order to, especially in these times of remote working, to be able to effectively discuss results and share results among the team, I developed a dashboard using open source tools. So these are the tools that I used. And I can really recommend that to any data scientist who might be in the audience. I'm just going to show briefly how it looks. Let me bring it up. Whoa. Yeah, here it is. So it's just a web page that everybody can, or the team, it's of course encrypted and secured, so the team can access it. And with it, you can look at the results of the different models. So here you see the ROC curves that I just show you for all the different data sets from the model that we just discussed. So you can, for instance, zoom in on, for instance, the validation set alone, and then it will show you the curve for that. Then you can adjust the classification threshold to set it to an operating point you like. And down below, you can show the images that are, in this case, I selected true positive images. So these will be the true positive predictions from the model and the corresponding segmented regions that it makes. You can, for instance, also select the false negative. So these are the, in this case, we have three false negatives, so they are shown here. And I really would like to stress, I think this really enables the multidisciplinary teamwork. It's also very educational for the students working on the team, and also very nice for them to see their annotations being used in practice like this, I think. So just to end with a brief outlook, also relating back to Vincent's introduction earlier. So I think we're still in the lab phase of this innovation funnel. We're still creating and testing. We have to expand and also curate our current data sets. That's work in process. And we have to cross-validate the results because the first results look promising, but we have to apply extreme scrutiny to these results. And a part of that is also temporal validation from data from 2019 within the UMCG. And as we are slowly moving into this pilot phase, we are now thinking about external validation. We've made several contacts pertaining to this to try and do this and also validate prospectively. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge the team working on this project, in particular the team from trauma surgery and all the students who have been really instrumental in this. And I'd like to acknowledge the funding we got from the Interreg project to make this project possible. So that concludes my presentation, and I'll be happy to take any questions if there are any.
Okay, thank you, Ludo, for that overview of the more technical part. Thanks also, Vincent, for the more clinical side of the project. We're running over time. People were already leaving because we are beyond 11 o'clock. Are there any questions that people still want to ask? Either to Ludo or Vincent, or maybe still to Jaap for his presentation. Can I see any hands or something in the chat? If not, I have one short question for Vincent to wrap it up. You talked about the application of computer-aided detection, and where you showed that adding the AI to the doctor would help them in their assessment, then they will have increased performance by that. What we know from CAD is also that there are examples where the expert does not increase in performance because they simply reject what the CAD finds. So could you shortly an idea how you think you could increase the acceptance of the medical doctor for these kind of AI tools?
Yeah, thank you for the question. That's a very interesting one. There are a lot of stubborn personalities in the hospital, and I am one of them. This question I've asked myself as well. So we got into contact with an ethicist, and we plan to, when we are going to pilot this in the clinical setting, to also interrogate strongly all the users that are involved in such a pilot. In what way do they accept an algorithm or reject it? And how can we, how is trust appreciated, and how do you measure trust? So it's a very interesting question. I do not know the answer, but it's something we need to investigate, surely.
Okay, thank you. I think we're gonna wrap up. Thank you all for being here. If you want to have extra information, get in touch with us through the Dash channels. You can also follow us on LinkedIn. The whole session of today is recorded. It will be available later on through the website of the UMCG on the Dash pages, through our YouTube channel. So keep an eye out for that if you want to re-listen or want to share this with other people also that you think might be interested in this session. So thanks all again. Thanks for all the presenters for giving their presentation. Thanks to Linda for setting up the technical part and the organization of this webinar, and hope to see you all in the next one. Thanks again. Bye-bye.